So acquiring nuclear weapons, there are really three different sort of components to getting them. One's the nuclear material, the highly enriched uranium or plutonium. And there are two aspects of that. One is you have to get the stuff, and the other is you have to convert it from whatever chemical form you got it from the production process into metallic components for a weapon core. You also need the non-nuclear weapon components to detonate the thing. This is usually high explosives, some detonators and whatnot. And finally, there are delivery systems. And while these could be quite diverse, you know, for big heavy weapons, they could be ships or trucks or something. These days, people are mostly focused on ballistic missiles, and not only that, ballistic missiles of the sort that North Korea or Iran might have. So we're going to look at all these aspects tonight. The only thing I'm not going to look at is the acquiring the nuclear material, which is all, most of the focus is often placed on, but I want to look at these other components. And we'll start with converting the nuclear material into the metallic weapon components. Next slide. There is some, and you know, important people like the International Institute of Strategic Studies invoking what they claimed were Russian nuclear weapon designers who claimed it would take 6 months just to convert the UF6 of HEU into metallic components. And this was sort of absurd, and also that it would involve, you'd waste a lot of the material, even though this material is extremely valuable. And you can look here at this curve from the Manhattan District Project, and I'll be talking a lot about the Manhattan Project because, of course, they were pushing things as fast as they could because of the war. Now, most other countries haven't been quite so pressed, but somebody like Iran, who may expect to get bombed by Israel or the US, might also want to try to push things. And this is a curve showing the HEU deliveries at Los Alamos by month. You can see, and this is only just U-235 part of the HEU. So the Hiroshima weapon required about 50 kilograms of U-235, is really about 52. And you can see from this curve that they were still producing material as late as July 15th, or delivering it to Los Alamos then. And yet the final weapon components for the Hiroshima weapon were finished only 9 days later. This is a far cry from 6 months. And I've looked at just the amount of material that was available. They couldn't have wasted much, no more than 3 to 6%. And there's probably a good deal less than that, because this material, of course, is probably more valuable than gold. One final thing I'll have you look at this chart is just where we were in December 1944. You can see this curves at about 6 kilograms of U-235, a far cry from the 50. Next slide. To talk about plutonium, we need to take a detour into metallurgy, in particular the concept of allotropes. Now, allotropes are different forms, crystal lattice forms of the same element. Now, the allotropes you could well be most familiar with are the allotropes of carbon, with graphite and diamonds, both being just carbon arranged differently. Now, unfortunately, it isn't easy to convert one of carbon's allotropes from one to the other, but for metals, that's not the case. For the metals that have different allotropic forms, and not all of them do, but the ones that do, that simply changing the temperature causes the allotropic forms to change. And by convention, the lowest temperature form is always called the alpha phase, the next the beta phase, and so on. And this is, I just chose uranium as an example. It has three forms, alpha, beta, gamma, and the different temperature range. The alpha to beta transition occurs at about 668 degrees centigrade, which is like about 1200 degrees Fahrenheit. And you can see there on the chart that the density changes significantly at each of these changes. And the different forms also have different physical properties as far as how easily they can be worked. Next slide. Plutonium was rather stunning. Most metals that have allotropic forms only have like two, or as you saw with uranium, three. Plutonium has six, which was the top of the list. And what is worse is the low temperature form alpha phase is brittle and undergoes the alpha beta transition at quite low temperature, 122 degrees C. And there are large density changes that occur at that point. Now, one of the good things about plutonium is the delta phase, which has much nicer physical properties. It's easily worked. And it was known from metallurgy that if you alloy metal with a small amount of another metal, you can often stabilize these higher temperature phases at lower temperatures as well. And indeed, this worked out for plutonium. And it was discovered that plutonium aluminum alloy stabilized the delta phase, and this seemed very promising. Now, unfortunately, when the Fat Man design was finalized, it used a rather conservative design, which I'll discuss a little more later. And so it didn't, the assembly time wasn't that fast. And it turns out, it was sort of well known that the alpha particles from various nuclides, including plutonium, when they strike many of the light elements like aluminum, produce neutrons. And because of the slow assembly time, it turned out the neutron production rate from the plutonium aluminum alloy was too high and it had to be ruled out. Now, fortunately, they had been experimenting with the small amounts of plutonium they had in the winter of 1945, and it appeared like they could make it work. And so they decided the alpha phase was the phase they were going to use for the Fat Man design. Next slide. Well, toward the end of April 1945, they finally started getting significant amounts of plutonium at Los Alamos from the Hanford reactors. And so in May, they made repeated attempts to manufacture large metal shapes using this plutonium, but they all warped, fractured, and cracked due to this beta-alpha transition. And this was kind of a problem. Now, in April, someone had noticed on the periodic table that gallium is next down from aluminum. And there was some hope that, well, maybe gallium plutonium alloy would also be beta stabilized. And indeed, it was, but nobody had looked at it very much because they were going to do alpha. And in fact, you can see this phase diagram shown here. If you see, if you use just 1% weight percent of gallium, then the delta phase is stabilized all the way down to the freezing point, actually well below that. So, in late May, sort of in a panic, it was suddenly decided, well, let's use plutonium gallium instead. Well, nobody had done any research on it. People didn't even know how stable it was, because in some instances, these stabilized phases are only sort of metastable and they'll change over time. But they looked for 6 whole weeks and it didn't change, and that they thought would be good enough to use for weapons. We now know it's at least decades. But they didn't then. But because of this change, they didn't determine the critical mass of this plutonium gallium alloy until June 24th. Yet they had the core ready only a week later in July the 1st for the Trinity test. So that's only a week to produce this core.